After what feels like light years worth of holdups, we finally have a first look at Star Trek Discovery. Will it boldly go where no Trek show has gone before? Is it more JJ than Gene? We've got Dan Merle here to discuss right here next on Screen Junkies News. After releasing a striking desert production shot earlier today, CBS has graced their upfronts and the internets with a long-awaited first look at Star Trek Discovery. We got a look at some of the main characters, including First Officer Michael Burnham, played by Sonequa Martin-Green, and the cinematic good looks of the production design. The show will be exclusive to CBS All Access, their current streaming service, and it is being positioned as the flagship show to bring in subscribers like so many tractor beams. Now, with me to discuss this new trailer is our resident Trekker, Trekkie, whatever you want to call it, Dan Merle.
The long and prosperous.
Sasha. Oh, I'm better now.
Yes.
First reaction.
First reaction.
Bad, indifferent?
Mixed, I think. Cautiously optimistic, perhaps. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's as a Trek fan, Star Trek has been off television for such a long time since. I mean, Enterprise, I guess, counts, but that was always kind of a lesser Star Trek series. Voyager was kind of the last, I think, pure Star Trek series that was on the air. Enterprise has its fans, but it wasn't quite as well received as the other ones. So it's always great to think that there's going to be a Star Trek TV show, I say on the air, but being produced. The pilot's going to be on CBS, and then it's going to go over to CBS All Access.
And they're hoping that this will make them sort of like a Hulu, an Amazon.
Sure.
It'll be their Netflix, the CBS, as if they don't have enough number one hits. This is how they're going to drive people to their online offering, which is actually really smart as a business model.
Well, I mean, if you're going to look for a fan base that's technologically proficient and passionate and knows how to do all this stuff, then Star Trek's not a bad place to start.
Absolutely.
So I think that, to be honest, I was a little. There's a lot of things going on with this trailer. I thought that, first of all, I think this is a very early look. This was a show that started really in production after so many delays. I mean, it was casting as far back as 2 or 3 months ago. So this is a show that's very much still being worked on.
Right.
Very much still in production. I think what we saw today is from very early in the show's run. I think what we saw today may be mostly from the pilot episode, if I had to wager a guess. I mean, just the degree to which a lot of these shots were done. There was no Jason Isaacs, who we know has been cast as, and this is the big question with a lot of people, as the captain, supposedly, of the Discovery, but we have Michelle Yeoh, who's all over this trailer, who's also the captain. Mm-hmm. There's two different ships. There's been speculation. Is the ship from the pilot going to be repurposed as the Discovery? If so, are there two captains? Are there two ships? These are things that we don't still 100% get the answers to.
Right. But what we did get some answers to is it looks amazing. I mean, the visuals are pretty stunning. We also know that this is supposed to take place 10 years before the sort of OG. What? Why do you make that face?
No, it's interesting.
It's very
we talk about the visuals.
Dan.
No, it's not cringy at all. It's this kind of defied my expectation a little bit, because when this was launched, they made a note of saying, like, this show is in the Star, what they call the Star Trek, this is going to get super nerdy now. They said this show is in the Star Trek Prime timeline. The Prime timeline is the timeline of Shatner and Nimoy and Patrick Stewart and Next Generation, of the TV show, of the movies, you know, Wrath of Khan. Like, that's the timeline that
movies
set the baseline for Star Trek.
Pre-Pine. Prime is pre-Pine.
Pre-Pine, yes. Yeah. And then you have the offshoot timeline, which is J.J. Abrams, which is called the Kelvin timeline. And that's kind of the alternate dimension in which these new movies take place. So when they announced the show, they're like, oh, this is in the Prime timeline. But the show looks exactly like the Kelvin timeline.
Yes.
And it kind of has the updated tech of that timeline. It has the feel,
suits, the
uniforms
suits.
Of that timeline. So that kind of threw my expectations a little bit. You know, not because I expect this. Of course, this is not going, shouldn't
feel. I just saw a lens flare.
Exactly, lens flares.
Oh, no.
This shouldn't look and feel like the original 60s show, of course, even though it's set in that era before, actually. This is kind of between Enterprise and the original Star Trek series.
Yep.
I would never expect it to look like that. But it did throw me how much it did look like the Abrams films, given what we're told about what timeline this is in. Adding in the fact that you're going to have original series characters in this show, and I'm very curious to see how they're going to do all that in the mix. Are they just going to completely disregard all timelines and just do their own thing?
Well, I wonder, do you think that maybe the look of it is to appeal to fans who are already fans of the films?
Sure.
And then the timeline itself can maybe be a little bit more amorphous in terms of what you're talking about, but I would hope they would stick with Prime. That's what TV's supposed to be for, and then the movies can do their own thing.
But the name of the game is marketing. Yep. And the younger generation for almost 10 years now have gotten used to the Chris Pine feel and look of Star Trek. So I'm not going to discredit it for looking like the movies. I think that that's kind of what this iteration of Star Trek looks like. And it just surprised me that they kind of made a point of saying it's going to be here, and then now it looks like it's set here.
Yeah.
I'm not putting that to discount. It just kind of put me back on my heels a little bit.
That was a great moment in the trailer, by the way. When that happened, I oohed.
Yeah.
I oohed and aahed all by myself.
I think that I like that they're setting up this part of Star Trek history that we haven't necessarily seen a lot of, which was the Klingon, more of the Klingon conflict.
Sure.
You know, the Klingons are enemies that first emerged in the original series. We're kind of going back a little bit. Again, this is hewing more to the feature timeline than the original series timeline. We're going back to deal with them. They have the look that they do in the new movies. So I'm kind of approaching this and expecting the vibe of the movies, even though they've said it's going to be in this, you know, TV verse. Mm-hmm. This looks very cinematic to me. And I'll be curious to see if they can do that on that level, on that stage, and for the budget that they have, considering that it is a streaming show, because
they're with putting a lot into
with effects and stuff, it's a very razor thin margin before you start looking like a fan film, and that's what they don't want. Want quality, and you want prestige, and you want people to feel like if they're going to be subscribing, you know, to the CBS All Access, like they're getting television quality entertainment.
Absolutely, but do you think that this will appeal beyond the fan base? Do you think that this will actually create a new generation, if dare I say it, of Star Trek fans?
I don't know. Because this looks weird. And that's not, again, that Star Trek is weird, but this looks weird. You have the alien death sense guy.
yeah.
You have the Klingons in there, who this is the most extreme design for Klingons that we've ever seen. It's very sci-fi, and that's always a tough sell. They're selling the action angle of it, which, again, smart. The TV has always been a little more ponderous, for good or bad. A lot of times Next Generation turned into, you know, a floating conference room in space, and
I love Next Generation. I used to watch Next Gen every day after school.
I love Next Generation. It is one of my favorite television shows of all time. I think it is maybe the best sci-fi television show of all time. However, from time to time, there are only so many viruses and peace treaties that you can negotiate before you're like, okay, let's spice it up a little bit. The other series went far the other way and got too cheesy sometimes. So they're selling the action angle. I think that means that they're going to go for a broader audience. But Star Trek is a tough sell. Star Trek Beyond didn't do that great at the box office last summer. It was a disappointment box office-wise, even though it was maybe the second best of the new movies. So I think it's going to be, if I'm being honest, Star Trek is a tough sell. You have a fan base, myself included, that is very protective of it, and I don't envy this job that they have, which is to make a TV show that can attract a new audience, not just attract a new audience, but attract an audience to a new medium.
Absolutely.
And also make a compelling television show.
Well, the other thing is that there's been some shakeup in terms of showrunners. Brian Fuller was there.
Yeah.
Now it's Alex Kurtzman, who has been involved in the films. But I think when you look at Star Trek, Battlestar Galactica, and even in some very small ways, go with me here, Firefly, I think that sometimes these shows are a little bit waylaid in the beginning. And then they either become huge cult sensations, or they find a different life, streaming services, or when people can binge them. I mean, that's really what I think happened with BSG. People didn't really jump on that bandwagon, and then suddenly they were like, oh, I can binge this whole thing, and now it has like a whole other life. And I wonder if that's going to happen here.
Well, yeah, Battlestar Galactica, I think it transcended a little bit. By the end of its run, I think people had kind of tapped into it. It had been on just
but
long enough.
But it took a really long time for people to find it.
Yeah, there There are many more cases of shows like Babylon 5, which was popular when it was on the air, but has gained a cult following.
Stargate
SG-1. Obviously Firefly is the canceled too early, but that's the good thing about sci-fi shows, or the silver lining is, even if you're not successful when you come out, there's a great chance that you can attract that cult following. They expanded the order today to 15 episodes. Yep. It was 10, then 13, now 15. I don't think that's a bad sign. I think that means that the studio's happy with what they're getting, and maybe the story's a little more complex than I anticipated. That's a good sign that they're not cutting episodes, that they're adding episodes, and that they're committing to producing those episodes.
I personally think that this show looks so awesome. I wasn't even going to think about doing CBS All Access. I was going to do the Netflix thing. I was just going to steal somebody's password. But now, I would totally spend $5 a month for this. This looks dope.
Yeah, I mean, Star Trek is the cornerstone science fiction television franchise. Mm-hmm. One of them in the movies, but for television, Star Trek, I think, is the keystone that all other sci-fi movies, TV shows are judged on. So as a Trek fan, I'm happy to see that it's coming back. I hope it's great. I like that we're seeing new alien races. I like that they're seeing new species. I hope that they don't rely too much on familiar faces from the future/past. I know that Rainn Wilson is rumored or confirmed to be playing Harry Mudd, who is an original series character. Spock's father, Sarek, is going to be in the show. I hope they do what Next Generation did, which was to pay homage to those characters, but blaze their own trail. And I'll give the show some time. I'm doing a rewatch right now of Next Generation, and the first season was a mess.
What?
The first season of Star Trek The Next Generation was a mess. They hadn't found their voice. They hadn't found their footing.
I remember it very nostalgically. So
yeah. So as with any TV show, I'm going to give it some time. I don't want to jump right to it, but I hope that they are given that time to carve their own little corner of the galaxy and not just be Star Trek reference of the week.
Oh, I hope so too. And honestly, this trailer gave me a lot of hope. I think it looks original. I think the production values look incredible. And I can't wait to see. And if this was just sort of a rip from the first pilot episode, that pilot episode they are putting a lot into. And we want to know what you guys thought of this trailer. Did it get you excited? Are you looking forward to seeing what happens when Discovery blazes its own trail? Let us know in the comments below. You can tweet us at SJ News. Make sure to like and subscribe. And of course, you can always click here for more Screen Junkies news.